Can carnitine be used for fatty liver disease instead of choline? Hi, I'm Chris Masterjohn, and I have a PhD in nutritional sciences. I am not a medical doctor, and nothing contained in this episode may be construed as medical or nutritional advice of any kind or a substitute, therefore. This episode is meant purely as scientific education. If you wish to act on any ideas presented in this episode, please consult your physician first and never take anything herein as a reason to contradict medical advice. With that said, enjoy the episode. Thomas Phillips says, you talked about working with fatty liver disease in one of your episodes. You recommended a very low fat diet along with choline. Can you use L-carnitine instead? Also, isn't this protocol you recommend more dependent upon an individual's SNPs, meaning the relevant SNPs for fat metabolism? Otherwise, wouldn't simply a calorie reduction to lose weight in general be just as effective? Thank you, Chris. Thank you, Thomas, for your question. There's a couple questions there. So the role of choline and the role of carnitine have nothing to do with one another. Choline is going to help move fat out of the liver. Carnitine is going to help fat get into the mitochondria to be burned for energy. So first of all, I think one thing that's important to note is that you're going to get more bang for the buck by fixing the things that are wrong rather than pulling on levers that are working perfectly fine. And so the data that I've seen, and I haven't been as involved in keeping up with the literature on fatty liver as intensively as I researched it when I was in graduate school and I was working in a lab that specialized in fatty liver. And I actually read, you know, insane numbers of papers to produce a very high quality review in the context of green tea, which is actually what, you know, everything that got cut from my review on green tea and fatty liver that was published in Nutrition Reviews. It was my doctoral advisor gotten invited by Nutrition Reviews to do the review, and he basically gave the task to me. I basically wrote it and he sort of acted as the editor and became the corresponding author. I became the lead author. And then the multitude of things that got cut from that review wound up as blog posts, hence all the stuff I've done on choline. One thing that I think is underappreciated is that in someone with fatty liver disease, the output of triglycerides from the liver is decreased. The beta oxidation of fatty acids in the liver is increased, not decreased. And it's because you have more fat in the liver. And when you have more fat in the liver, you increase the pressure to burn those fatty acids for fuel. And so you do burn those fatty acids for fuel as one of the protections against free fatty acid toxicity. So if you can't get rid of triglycerides from the liver, you have more triglycerides in the liver, which through cyclical conversion of triglycerides to fatty acids and vice versa, those triglycerides become an extra source of fatty acids, and free fatty acids can, above a certain level, produce cellular toxicity. So you basically have every compensation running that you can to minimize free fatty acid levels by increasing triglyceride synthesis and increasing the burning of fatty acids for energy. So triglyceride synthesis and beta oxidation of fatty acids are both increased in fatty liver disease, not decreased. And that's because export of triglycerides from the liver is decreased. Yes, if you add L-carnitine, at least up to some point, you have the potential to increase beta oxidation. And triglyceride output from the liver requires choline, but ketone output from the liver does not. So if you beta oxidize the fatty acids, you get more ketones, and the ketones freely escape from the liver, that will decrease the amount of fat in the liver. So it does have the potential for protection. That, of course, assumes that the average person who has fatty liver does not have enough carnitine to drive those fatty acids into the mitochondria. And that's not clear to me because, as I said before, beta oxidation is actually increased in fatty liver. So you might get an effect from that. You might not, depending on the carnitine status of the person's liver cells. but under no circumstances will it ever be interchangeable with choline, because choline is doing something totally different. And you probably, in almost every case, will be more likely to get more bang for the buck out of choline, because export of triglycerides from the liver is actually compromised rather than increased, like mitochondrial transport of fatty acids for beta oxidation is. And because it's been shown that average intakes of choline are not adequate to fully protect the liver, and variations in, and choline is an essential nutrient, unlike carnitine, and variations in choline, well, you can debate that. I mean, maybe they're both could be classified as conditionally essential. We do have some synthesis of choline. But choline is essential in the sense that the average person's choline intake is borderline at best to maximally protect the liver. And it doesn't take very long to cause harm to the liver by putting someone on a low choline diet compared to what they're usually eating. So I think you're overwhelmingly more probable to get more bang for the buck out of choline, because you're addressing something that is actually a problem in most people and is probably much more of a problem in the general population, especially the population who has fatty liver. But with that said, I think part of what you want to do in a protocol is make it robust. And so you diversify the approaches in order to maximize the probability that whatever levers you're pulling, at least one of them is going to work. And so what you really want to do is pull multiple levers so that even if one doesn't work, one of the other ones did. Now, if you have something with higher risk, it's different, right? Like if there's significant risk to pulling one of the levers, then you want to collect data before you pull the lever. And maybe that data is the individual's SNPs. But if there is no harm in pulling the lever, then it's not that important to collect the data about which lever to pull, especially if you just want to see results fast. And the fact is that, you know, it if you had something measurable that would change with status, it's generally better to collect the information before you institute the protocol so that you can know whether you were fixing a problem or not, because that can provide you better information about which part of the protocol worked, and it can provide you better motivation to keep that up if you have evidence that you're actually fixing a problem. But if the problem is the individual's SNPs, the person's genetics aren't going to change, and so you can measure that at any time, even retrospectively, which dramatically decreases the value of necessarily gathering that information before you decide what protocol to do. In terms of whether there are SNPs that would change the protocol, not really. There's a very common polymorphism in the PEMT enzyme, which is required to synthesize phosphatidylcholine. I think that makes you more likely to get fatty liver if you don't get enough choline. But I don't really think it changes whether getting enough choline would help with fatty liver. Maybe it changes the degree to which it works, but it doesn't change the principle. And so I don't think that would change that. In terms of SNPs and fat metabolism, I don't know. Maybe you could give me specific examples that might change my mind, but I don't see why that would be relevant. In terms of calorie reduction to lose weight, wouldn't that be just as effective? No, it would be effective, but it wouldn't be as effective as also pulling all the levers that will export fat from the liver. The reason that overweight is generally associated with fatty liver is because when you have more total fat, you have, there's two basic reasons. So one is, and these are kind of subsections of the same reason. So when you have more total fat and you start exceeding the capacity to store fat in the healthy way, you start storing fat in the unhealthy way. So when someone crosses their personal fat threshold, meaning the threshold at which they start to develop health problems from having too much body fat, then they become less effective at storing fat. So there's more free fatty acids circulating, when there's more free fatty acids circulating, there's more triglycerides that can be synthesized in the liver. So the liver has more exposure to triglycerides. The sort of part B of the same reason is that when you have more overweight, this might vary between different people, but you will always have more visceral fat. And the visceral fat pad is the one fat pad that empties straight into the portal vein, which means that all of the free fatty acids that leave it during the cyclical release of fatty acids and return of triglycerides, all of the fatty acids will go to the liver first, where they can become triglycerides. So especially with more visceral fat, the liver gets more exposure to triglycerides. None of that ever trumps the export of triglycerides from the liver. If you have maximal capacity to export triglycerides from the liver, it doesn't matter how much triglyceride the liver is exposed to. It only matters for fatty liver if the amount of triglyceride exposure in the liver exceeds the capacity of the liver to export it. Weight loss is an important component of a fatty liver reversal program if the person is overweight, which in 86% or so of cases of fatty liver, they will be overweight, probably obese. So yes, if that is a lever to pull, you pull it. If the person's not overweight, you don't pull that lever. You know, if someone's normal weight, you don't cause them to lose more weight when they don't need to lose weight, because that would actually at least temporarily increase the liver's exposure to fatty acids unnecessarily. But that's not the be all. Even though overweight tremendously predisposes someone to fatty liver, that doesn't mean that it is the be all end all of fatty liver. And particularly when all overweight in the modern context is juxtaposed on top of a mediocre choline intake at best. And so it's probably the case that that you could just pull the triglyceride export lever and improve fatty liver without impacting weight. But why would you want to decrease the liver's exposure to fat without also increasing its ability to export fat? Especially when weight loss will at least acutely and temporarily increase the exposure of the liver to fat, right? So yeah, you're emptying the visceral fat pad, which will in time translate into less exposure of the liver to fat, but you're also releasing all the subcutaneous fat more than usual when you're losing weight. So if anything, when you lose weight, that would be a time to put more emphasis on exporting triglycerides from the liver so that the weight loss doesn't temporarily translate into increased fatty liver. But anyway, these are all just different components, different levers to pull, and none of them are interchangeable with each other. So I think the appropriate thing to do is to do all of them, not to just pick one of them and expect that to be as effective, because it might be adequate, but you don't just want something to be potentially adequate. You want it to be robust, and robusticity requires having diversification across uncorrelated things. If you had an economic portfolio and you wanted to make sure that if you lost money on one thing, you didn't lose money overall. You want to diversify across things that aren't going to go up and down at the same time with each other. So here, you want to diversify across things that aren't just all pounding on making sure you can burn fat. You want to diversify across decreased the exposure of the liver to triglycerides, increase the ability of the liver to get rid of the fat, increase the ability of the liver to burn the fat. Those are three totally different things that all help work together, and if one of them happens not to work, they're not interdependent on one another, even though they help each other work, so that if one fails, the other two will catch, will carry the protocol through. All right, hope that helps, Thomas.
This episode was part of a Q&A for members of the CMJ MasterPass, a buyer's club with exclusive and massive discounts on your favorite premium foods and health products, including pasture-raised and wild meat and seafood, supplements, sleep accessories, water filters, phototherapy devices, and much more. As a bonus, you also get to participate in monthly private Zoom Q&As with me. You can join the MasterPass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code Q&A, spelled out as Q-A-N-D-A, Q&A, for a 10% lifetime discount. For the remainder of 2020, I will be working full-time on finishing my Vitamins and Minerals 101 book while reserving a portion of my time for consulting clients. You can pre-order my book at chrismasterjohnphd.com/book. In my consulting, I am neither a medical practitioner nor a coach. I serve as your data analyst and your strategist. I teach you scientific principles of health and wellness, help you analyze your data, and help brainstorm actionable strategies. You can sign up for a consultation at chrismasterjohnphd.com/consultations. I will try to respond to comments here when I can, but my presence will be intermittent while I'm finishing my book. I hope you enjoyed this, and I will see you in the next episode.